In the beginning, our ancestors knew not. They studied. For 4,000 years, they learned all there was to know. They taught others. Then came the Maafa, the great disaster. Enslavers made it illegal for Africans to read and write. They were forced to forget all they had learned and taught. After 400 years of forgetting, they forgot they had forgotten. That changes today. I will remember for them. I will read for them. I will write for them. I will teach for them. I will make certain they are never forgotten again. I'm Tony Browder, and welcome to the first in a series of programs on my book, From the Browder File. But before we get started with the program, I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I was born to in a single-parent household. My mother was 16 when I was born. She lived with her parents on the west side of Chicago. My mother was always interested in my getting the best quality of education that I could. And so when I entered high school, we moved from Chicago to Oak Park, which is a western suburb of the city. And during that time, we were the second African-American family to live in Oak Park. And my 3 years at Oak Park River Forest High School, out of a student body of over 3,000 students, there were never more than two African Americans in the entire school. I received a great education. I learned to love learning, I learned to love reading, but I also learned that there was a profound absence of information about who I was as a person of African ancestry. This was in the 60s, late 1960s, during the height of the Black Power Movement and the Black Consciousness Movement. And so I was imbued with a sense of Black pride, living and going to school in an all-white environment. After high school, I attended the University of Illinois for one semester, where I majored in architecture, and then later changed my major when I relocated to Howard University. My background is in graphic design and advertising, and I became interested in history and culture only after graduating from Howard University, when I began to learn the truth about who I was as a person of African ancestry. So this journey to enlightenment, if you will, has prompted me to begin to learn more about who I was as a person of African ancestry, document my knowledge through my writings and through my illustrations, drawings, and then begin to perform lectures and seminars as I traveled around the country, and then also traveled throughout Africa and in the world, documenting this newfound information about our collective history and culture. So I came to write The Browder File as a result of my appearing on the Kathy Hughes Morning Show in 1986 in Washington, D.C. Ms. Hughes was so impressed with my body of knowledge that she invited me to come as a regular guest on her show. But it was my first appearance on the Kathy Hughes Morning Show that prompted a call from Frances Murphy, who taught in Howard University School of Communication. She was the publisher of the Washington Afro-American newspaper and invited me to write an article about one of the subject matters on my first interview. That subject matter was the creation of the Negro. And after our initial conversation, I agreed to write a bi-weekly column about various aspects of African and African-American history and culture. I wrote those columns over the course of 2 years, and that is what constituted my first book entitled From the Browder File, 22 Essays on the African American Experience. What really set in motion this program that you're engaged in now through the Browder Scholars is the letters that I received from dozens of incarcerated African American men during the 1990s. I received dozens of letters every month from young brothers, primarily, who were locked behind bars and were reading for the first time in their lives, who had structure in their lives for the first time. And many of the letters said that my book, From the Browder File, was the first book that they read from cover to cover. And as a result of them reading about African and African-American history and culture, they began to take greater pride in themselves and began to understand how and why they were led astray. It was essentially an absence of knowledge of self that resulted in them disrespecting themselves by committing crimes against people in their own community, selling drugs, getting in fights, and robbing, and ultimately killing other people. And so as a result of them reading, they now began to see themselves differently. And many of the letters expressed the same comments, that they wished they had read this book earlier in their life, such that they wouldn't be doing 10, 15, 20 years in prison or life in prison. And another frequently asked question in their letters was, how could they get this information to their children so that they wouldn't follow in their parents' footsteps? This prompted me to begin to look at what I could do to begin to get more of this information contained in the Browder File to our young men and women before they walked down the wrong path and wound up incarcerated. So we initiated the Browder Scholars Program in order to bring together a cadre of African-American students primarily and expose them to knowledge and information that they likely will not find in their educational experience, their formal educational experience, that is in elementary school, high school, and unfortunately, college. There is forbidden information that is not allowed to be a part of our traditional educational system. And I've learned to encourage our people to read, because it's in cultivating an appetite for reading that you can begin to understand why, when our ancestors were enslaved hundreds of years ago here in this country, the United States of America, you'll begin to understand why it was illegal for people of African ancestry who had been stolen from their homeland to read narratives about where they came from, to record how they were stolen, how they were being abused. Our inability to access accurate knowledge of self is what contributes to our continued lack of respect for each other and us functioning like a lost people. And so once I began to learn the power of knowledge, the power of reading, and how sharing this information with others could transform their lives, I began organizing a series of lectures in Washington, D.C., beginning in 1987. And our first guest speaker was Dr. Asa G. Hilliard III. Dr. Hilliard was an educational psychologist. He was a historian, and grew to be a very close friend and jegna of mine. We use the word jegna as opposed to mentor, because a jegna is a Amharic term that comes from Ethiopia in East Africa and represents a person who is a defender of the culture, one who imparts historical and cultural information to a young person in order to put their feet on a path that will lead to them becoming positive and productive adults within their community. It was my relationship with Dr. Hilliard that led to my inviting him to write the introduction to From the Browder File when it was published in 1989. Now, in 1989, very few people had ever heard of Tony Browder or Anthony Browder, but people throughout the United States and around the world knew of Dr. Hilliard. They knew of his work as a psychologist. They knew of his work as a master educator. They knew of his work as a historian, a person who had taken thousands of teachers and administrators on his annual study tours to Egypt, where he literally transformed their minds as a result of showing them the 5,000-year-old history that our ancestors had created in the Nile Valley. Dr. Hilliard, in his introduction to From the Browder File, listed 10 factors that contribute to a sense of disunity among people of African ancestry, and he talked about the need to establish a mental declaration of independence, the need to become conscientious thinkers. And so those 10 things helped to set a foundation for how people should use this book, From the Browder File. And I'd like to just reference those 10 points very quickly so that you can understand the factors that happened hundreds of years ago that contribute to our current state of disunity and disarray. And that by understanding how these forces still impact us over 100 years after slavery ended, we can begin to assume personal responsibility for changing how we think, changing how we act, and modeling for ourselves, our community, and our children what it is real culturally empowered African men and women are supposed to do and how they're supposed to conduct themselves. So briefly, I want to highlight these 10 things that Dr. Hilliard said that contribute to our lack of a sense of unity and direction. The first is that we let our names go. We don't know who we are. We don't know where we came from in Africa. The second point is that we have surrendered our way of life and our culture. We have adopted the ways of life of people unlike ourselves. And the third point is that we've lost our appetite because we lost our names and have surrendered our way of life and our culture. And what usually happens is that when a person develops an African-centered consciousness and seeks to share this information with their family members and friends, one of the statements that is often heard is, oh, here you go talking that black stuff again, as if there's something wrong with us talking about who we are and lifting up the story of our ancestors. We are black, we will be black all of our lives. And so the best thing that we can do is celebrate who we are by studying our history and our culture, modeling that for our young people, and teaching them how to be proud of their ancestry. The fourth point that Dr. Hilliard raised was that we have a general loss of memory. That is, few of us can begin the story of African people without beginning that story in our enslavement, as if our enslavement was the only thing that has ever happened to us. That is a lie. That was a lie that was created and perpetuated by our enslavers in order to keep us mentally enslaved. And as Dr. Hilliard often said, mental slavery is worse than physical slavery, because a mental slave believes that he or she is free and they never realize that the shackles are on our minds. The fifth point that he raised is that we have created false memories. We have inaccurate memories of African people, African history, and African culture. We also have inaccurate memories of European history, European people, and European culture. We in America have been taught to believe that Christopher Columbus discovered America. And one fundamental reality that we have to come face to face with is, how can someone discover a land when the people are already there? And it was Columbus's discovery of America in 1492, which set the framework for the decimation of the indigenous people of this land, who we mistakenly still refer to today as Indians. And then with their decimation, it set up the process for the European enslavement of African people, which has resulted in the death of over 50 million men, women, and children who were stolen from their homelands in West Africa. So with the theft of African people, with the destruction of the history and culture and memory of indigenous people, Europeans fabricated lies to elevate themselves as heroes, as discoverers, as men of great worth, when in fact the historical record documents that they have been among the world's greatest thieves, liars, and manipulators. So part of the journey that I encourage you all to partake in this reading of the Browder File essays is a journey to enlightenment, where we'll begin to learn the truth about ourselves and a greater understanding of who others are who continue to influence our lives today. The sixth point that Dr. Hilliard raised is that we've lost our land. We've lost our moorings of the land. We've lost Africa. For over 400 years, African people were stolen from the motherland. And then for almost 100 years, Europeans came in and divided Africa, colonized Africa, and took advantage of all of the resources there and exploited them for their own personal gain. As a result of over 500 years of the theft of people, land, and resources, Africa is poor and Europe is rich. The only reason why Europe is rich is that she has stolen African people and African resources. The only reason why Africa is poor is because of the loss of over 50 million people and an untold amount of gold, diamonds, and other resources which have empowered the world for hundreds and hundreds of years. The seventh point that Dr. Hilliard referenced is that we've lost our independent production capacity. We've been programmed. We've been socialized to be consumers rather than producers. Our ancestors were responsible for creating the oldest documented civilization on this planet. We have been responsible for being the first human beings to read, to write, and reason. But now we've been socialized to consume everything that has been fashioned by this European world and embrace that or consume this content as if it's the only thing of value. So we have to begin to understand who we were so that we can become those great people again. The eighth point that Dr. Hilliard referenced is that we've lost independent control of ourselves. We no longer control our neighborhoods, our communities. We no longer control the means of employment, our jobs. We no longer control our educational systems or the media which socializes our behaviors. These are all things that are critical to our development as individuals and as a collective people. This is all something that's very important in terms of shaping the minds of young people. Whoever controls your educational system determines what you know, and what you know determines how you think and how you act. Whoever controls the media determines your perception of self, determines what are legitimate and illegitimate modes of communication and behavior. And as we know all too well by looking at the media, whether it's television, radio, print media, film, or videos, we continue to be presented in ways that sap our humanity and show us as people who are undesirable, criminals, hustlers, and people that no one in their sane mind would want to identify with. So we have to regain control of the systems which influence our thoughts and our behavior, our educational systems, our media systems, and the means of employment, so that we can empower ourselves and support those individuals and institutions that will help bring out the best within ourselves and the best within future generations. And then Dr. Hilliard said that we've lost our sensitivity. This is the ninth point that he referenced. We've lost the ability to be aware of when other people are disparaging us, and we accept inaccurate portrayals of African people as if they are true. So when you have internalized negative perceptions of reality, you will subconsciously embrace those negative perceptions as authentic for yourself. So it's about knowing who you are. It's about acting on that knowledge and sharing that knowledge with others, that you can begin the process of a journey to enlightenment. It's only through this process of restoring your historical and cultural memory that you can become your true and authentic self. The 10th point that Dr. Hilliard makes is that as a cumulative result of all of these things, we've lost our sense of unity and direction. And so the only recourse for those of us who take the time to read and study accurate portrayals of the continuous contributions of African people to history and culture, it's only by rediscovering this new information that we can begin to know our true selves, begin to act and speak in a way that glorifies our ancestors and models for our young people who they have the capacity to become. So these are the basic goals of the essays in From the Brow to File: to introduce to you information that most of us will never receive in a formal educational environment, and to show you how to internalize this historical information, to conduct more research into the subject matters that I referenced, so that this knowledge, this new information, can now guide you down a path that will lead to you making positive contributions to your family, to your community, and to the African world. So enjoy your read and discussion of From the Brow to File, and let it put you on the path to enlightenment. Go.
Transition 14. In the beginning, our ancestors knew not. They studied. For thousands of years, they learned all there was to know, and they taught others. They came to Maafa, the great disaster. Enslavers made it illegal for Africans to read and write. They were forced to forget all they had learned and taught. After 400 years of forgetting, they forgot they had forgotten. That changes today. I will remember for them, I will read for them, I will write for them, I will teach for them. I will make sure they are never forgotten again.